This conference will now be recorded.
Good morning to all. Today I am going to tell about the anatomy of the larynx. Larynx is nothing but it is an organ of phonation. It is also an air passage or the airway passage and acts as a sphincter for the inlet of the lower respiratory passage. It also controls the entry of the water and expulsion of the air from the lungs, that is preventing from the aspiration risk. Coming to the embryology, at 4 weeks of intrauterine life, an outgrowth at the ventral aspect of the primitive foregut forms the primordial respiratory system. The epithelium of the larynx, trachea and bronchi is of endodermal origin, and other soft tissues like the cartilages and muscle arise from the splanchnic mesoderm, and that is from the fourth and sixth branchial arches. And the arytenoid swellings develop on either sides of the tracheobronchial diverticulum, and the epiglottis from the hypobronchial eminence, and thyroid cartilage from the fourth and sixth arches, and the cricoid, corniculate, cuneiform and intrinsic muscles from the sixth arch. This is the picture showing the embryology of the larynx, and these are the second arch, third arch, fourth arch, fifth and sixth arches, and the and from the second arch there will be hypobronchial eminence, and from the fifth arch it disappears, and fourth and sixth arches develop into the larynx. Anatomy of the larynx: extend from the root of the tongue to the trachea, that is, in males it lies in front of the third to sixth cervical vertebra, and it is in case of females it is very much higher, and in the case of infantile larynx, that larynx is smaller than the adult and is more funnel shaped. So the narrowest part is at the junction of the subglottic larynx with the trachea in the case of infantile larynx, that is, in the subglottic region. Normally in the case of adults, the narrowest part is nothing but the glottic part because of the presence of the vocal cords. Size, in males it is about 44 mm in size, and in the case of females it is about 36 mm. Male larynx grows rapidly at the puberty, and what constituents of the larynx are the cartilages, joints, segments and membranes, muscles, and the cavity which is lined by the mucous membrane, inner side. This is the anatomical picture of the larynx showing different membranes and also the ligaments. This is the thyroid cartilage, as you can see. This is the thyroid notch, and this is the cricoid cartilage. This is the trachea, first tracheal ring, second tracheal ring, and this is the cricotracheal ligament, and it is the cricothyroid ligament, and it is the median thyrohyoid ligament, and these are the lateral thyrohyoid ligament. Within these are the tritischia, that is the smaller cartilages which is present within the quadrilateral lateral thyrohyoid membrane. This is the lateral view of the larynx showing arytenoid cartilage present over the cricoid cartilage. This is the cricoarytenoid joint. This is the arytenoid, which is triangular shape or pyramidal shape. This is the vocal fold or vocal ligament, and this is the thyroid cartilage. This is the cricovocal ligament. Laryngeal cartilages are divided into unpaired and paired. That is, the unpaired cartilages are thyroid cartilage, cricoid cartilage, epiglottis, which are present centrally and also single. They are only one in number. And paired cartilages are arytenoid, which are present on both sides, corniculate and cuneiform. And coming to thyroid bone, it is a U-shaped bone with greater and lesser horns, and consists of body anteriorly. It is the body, and greater cornua projects backwards on each side of the body, whereas lesser cornua are attached to the upper aspect of the body laterally. These are lesser horns, and these are the greater horns. This is the body of the hyoid, and hyoid gives attachment to the extrinsic muscles of the larynx, like sternohyoid, thyrohyoid. These are the extrinsic muscles, and also some of the hyoglossus muscles. And hyoid gives extrinsic muscles suspending the larynx in the neck. Thyroid cartilage. It is a thyroid hyaline cartilage composed of two lamina fused in the middle and anteriorly at the lower part, forming the laryngeal prominence, at upper part forming the thyroid notch. This is the thyroid notch, and this is the laryngeal prominence, which can be palpated over the neck, and this is thyroid, no? It is also can be palpated. This is the superior cornua and this is the inferior cornua. This is the posterior view, this is the anterior view. In males, it is angulated at 90 degrees, and in the case of females, it is 120 degrees. This is the angle. This is the angle. In males, it is 90 degrees, and in the case of females, it is 120. Posterior border of the each lamina prolongs above and below the below and forms the superior and inferior cornua, as I have shown previously. Medial surface of the lower end has vowel facet joint for articulation with the cricoidal cartilage. This has got the facet for the cricoid cartilage attachment. External surface of the each lamina is the oblique line runs downwards and forwards from superior thyroid tubercle to inferior thyroid tubercle. It gives attachment to the several muscles of the larynx. This is the lamina. There will be the oblique line over this, which gives attachment to several muscles of this, extrinsic muscles of the larynx. And this is the cricoid cartilage. This is also the hyaline cartilage. Only complete cartilage is in the airway. Trachea are the C-shaped cartilage. Trachea consists of C-shaped cartilage, and also thyroid is also free on the posterior side. But in the case of cricoid, it is a complete ring, and which has narrow anterior part and the broad posterior part. These are called as lamina. And lamina projects upwards and articulates superior with the arytenoid cartilage. This is the lamina. This is the anterior view. This is the posterior view. In the posterior view, you can see the lamina clearly. And in the lateral view, you can see the arytenoid, which is placed over the lamina. This is called as cricoarytenoid joint. And inferior corner of the thyroid articulates with the cricoid at the junction of the arch and lamina. And entire inner surface is lined with the mucous membrane. It is at risk of necrosis and circumferential scarring resulting in subglottic stenosis. That is the complete ring. Whenever there is an injury into the inner mucosal layer of the cricoid cartilage or the trachea or the larynx, there will be some inflammation and there will be granulation tissue formation, and subsequently there will be scarring which leads to subglottic stenosis. Arytenoid cartilage, these are paired cartilages. And these are two small pyramidal shaped cartilages lying on the upper border of the lamina of the cricoid cartilage. This is the cricoid cartilage, and over this is the arytenoid cartilages, which are present over the lamina of the cricoid cartilage. Apex articulates with the corniculate, and these are the apex where the corniculate attaches, and base with the lateral part of the upper border of the cricoid lamina. This is the base of the cricoid cartilages. And here will be the attachment with the cricoid cartilage. And base is prolonged anterior to from the vocal process. This is the vocal process to which the vocal ligament or the vocal fold attaches. And lateral to form the muscular process. This is the muscular process where the posterior cricoarytenoid muscle attaches or the interarytenoid muscle attaches to which the intrinsic muscles of the larynx are attached. Again, this is another picture which shows the cricoid arytenoid cartilage present over the cricoid lamina. This is the cricoarytenoid joint or the facet over which the arytenoid cartilage is present. This is the corniculate cartilage and this is the cricoid cartilage. This is the posterior lamina, anterior cricoid. It is a complete cartilaginous. This is the muscular process and this is the vocal process. Epiglottis is a leaf-shaped structure in the anterior wall of the upper part of the larynx. Upper end is free and projects behind the hyoid and tongue, and the lower end is pointed and attached to the upper part of the angle between the two lamina of the thyroid cartilage by the thyroepiglottic ligament. Right and left margins provide attachment to the area epiglottic folds, and anterior surface is connected to the tongue by the median glossoepiglottic folds and to the hyoid by the hyoepiglottic ligament. Posterior surface is covered by the mucous membrane. And the anterior surface separated from the thyroid membrane, and the upper part of the thyroid cartilage by the potential space filled with fat, which is called as pre-epiglottic space. This pre-epiglottic space has got clinical significance because in the case of carcinoma of the supraglottic larynx, there will be spread of tumor from the supraglottic into the pre-epiglottic space and also into the base of it. This is the picture showing is the lateral view. This is the epiglottis. This is the higher epiglottic ligament. This is the thyrohyoid membrane. This is the pre-epiglottic space, which is filled with the fat. And in the case of supraglottic carcinomas, it has got the small pit-like deficiencies within the epiglottis. This is the elastic cartilage. And through these pit-like surfaces, the carcinoma can spread into the pre-epiglottic space and into the base of the tongue. It is also called as vellicular. This is the quadrangular membrane. It is the vocal fold, arytenoid, cricoid, and corticulate cartilage. Corniculate cartilage of Santorini. These are the pre-elastic cartilages which are articulated with the apex of the arytenoid, situated in the posterior part of the AE fold. And the another pair of cartilages are the cuneiform cartilage. These are also called as cuneiform cartilages whisper. And elastic rod-shaped situated cartilages which are situated in the AE fold in front of the corniculate and provide spatial support to the folds. They only provide the support to the folds. And the laryngeal joints, there are two in number, cricothyroid joint and cricoarytenoid joint. Cricothyroid joint is both are synovial joints. Cricothyroid joints, it favors the rotatory movements around the transverse axis and gliding movements. And so they are helpful in the tension of the vocal cords or the loosening of the vocal cords. And in the case of cricoarytenoid joint, it is also a synovial joint, which favors rotatory movement around the vertical axis, that is closing or opening of the glottis or the abducting or attacking the vocal cords. This has got the gliding movement, closing and opening posterior part of the glottis. Laryngeal membranes, these are of extrinsic membranes and intrinsic membranes. Extrinsic membranes are the thyrohyoid membrane, which is pierced by the superior laryngeal veins and internal laryngeal nerve. Tracheal membrane, another one is the cricothyroid membrane. Intrinsic membranes are cricovocal membrane, which is triangular fibroblastic membrane. Its upper border is free and stretches between the middle of the thyroid angle to the vocal process of the arytenoid and forms the vocal ligament. And its lower border is attached to the arch of the cricoid cartilage. And from its lower attachment, the membrane proceeds far upwards medially and thus with its fellow on opposite side forms the collus elasticus. Subglottic foreign bodies get impacted here because it is narrow segment here. Quadrangular membrane and lies deep to the mucosa of the AE folds and stretches between the epiglottis and the arytenoid cartilages. Its lower border forms the vestibular ligament, which lies in the false part. Coming to the muscles of the larynx, these are extrinsic and intrinsic muscles. And in the case of extrinsic muscles, they attach larynx to the neighboring structure and maintain its position in the neck. These are divided into two groups. These extrinsic muscles are divided into two groups. These are infrahyoid muscles and the suprahyoid muscles. Infrahyoid group consists of thyrohyoid, sternohyoid, sternothyroid. Whereas in the case of suprahyoid group, these are mylohyoid, geniohyoid, stylohyoid, digastric, stylopharyngeus, palatopharyngeus, salpingopharyngeus. These all muscles support the larynx. And extrinsic muscles attached to the head, these are the depressors, sternothyroid, you can see clearly in the picture, and this is the sternothyroid, and sternohyoid, this is the sternohyoid muscle, and thyrohyoid, from thyroid oblique line, this is the oblique line, and onto the thyroid hyoid bone, this is the thyrohyoid. Elevators are palatopharyngeus and salpingopharyngeus. These are present over the soft palate. Palatopharyngeus and stylopharyngeus. Infrahyoid group of muscles are the thyrohyoid. These are attached. Origin is thyrohyoid muscle origin is oblique line of the thyroid lamina. Insertion point is inferior branch of the greater corner of the hyoid. Inferior border of the greater corner of the hyoid. Whereas in the function, they depress the hyoid on fixed larynx. And the innervation is hypoglossal nerve, that is C1 root. And sternothyroid, it is on the posterior surface of the manubrium and edge of the first costal cartilage, that is sternum. And insertion point is oblique line of the thyroid lamina. The main function is depresses the larynx and the nerve supplies and the cervicalis nerve, that is C2-3 roots. Third one is the sternothyroid. The originates from the clavicle and posterior surface of the manubrium, whereas in the case of insertion, lower edge of the body of the hiatus, and it depresses the larynx by lowering the hiatus. Here also the nerves are placed and the cervical. Likewise, in the mylohyoid, the origin is from the mylohyoid line on the inner aspect of the mandible, and insertion is midline raphe on the body of the hiatus, and functions are raises and pulls the hiatus anteriorly. The main innervation is from the nerve to mylohyoid, which is a branch of the inferior alveolar branch of the mandibular nerve. Next muscle is the geniohyoid. It is from the genial tubercle on the mandible and insertion onto the upper border of the body of the hiatus. It raises and pulls the hiatus forwards, and the nerve supplies from the hypoglossal nerve. And another suprahyoid muscle, group of muscles are the stylohyoid. That is back of the styloid process. The origin is from the back of the styloid process, and the insertion is onto the base of the greater corner of the hiatus. And function is retractor and elevator of the larynx for swallowing. And the innervation is from the facial nerve, as it is from the second brachial arch. Digastric notch on the medial surface of the mastoid prominence, and insertion, it is onto the lower quarter of the mandible. And function is mainly anterior belly, it pulls the hiatus anteriorly and up, whereas the posterior belly has got posterior and up movement. Innervation is from the anterior belly, has got nerve supply from the mylohyoid nerve, and the posterior belly from the facial nerve, as it is from the second brain arch. Another one is stylopharyngeus. It originates from the medial aspect of the styloid process and inserts onto the posterior border of the lamina of the thyroid cartilage, and it elevates the larynx. The nerve supply is from the glossopharyngeal nerve. Next one is stylopharyngeus. And palatopharyngeus has got its origin from the palatine aponeurosis and posterior border of the hard palate. That is from the soft palate. Palatine aponeurosis nothing but it is in the soft palate, and the insertion is into the posterior border of the thyroid, alar, and the cornu. And function is it tilts the larynx forwards, and nerve supply is from the axillary nerve. Salpingopharyngeus originates from the eustachian tube. Insertion onto the posterior part of thyroid cartilage. Function is mainly it elevates the larynx, and pharyngeal plexus is the nerve supply. Intrahyoid relax and suprahyoid contracts. This facilitates the laryngeal elevation and elastic recoil of the trachea and the lower respiratory tract, and relaxation of the suprahyoid muscle cause the descent of the larynx. Intrinsic muscles, they move the cartilages of the larynx, that is they help in the voice production and also the airway production, that in the case of aspiration or anything, and they control the positional shape of the vocal cord, elasticity and viscosity of the each layer. They act to move the arytenoid at the cricoarytenoid joint, and the arytenoids rotate inwards and downwards to close and upwards and outwards to open the glottis. This is the picture showing the intrinsic muscles of the larynx. This is the cricothyroid muscle, and this is the thyroarytenoid muscle, and this is the vocal ligament. Vocal ligament is divided of the muscles, and this is the muscular process of the arytenoid, which has got attachment with the lateral cricoarytenoid and lateral cricothyroid, and the posterior cricoarytenoid is the posterior cricoarytenoid, and this is the lateral cricoarytenoid muscle, and this is the interarytenoid muscle. So it has got transverse and oblique parts. Intrinsic muscles of the larynx opens and close the larynx glottis. Posterior cricoarytenoid muscle originates from the lower and medial surface of the body of the cricoid lamina. You can see here from the cricoid lamina, and insertion onto the muscular process of the arytenoid. Here this is the muscular process of the arytenoid. This is the posterior cricoarytenoid. It arises from the cricoid lamina, attaches onto the muscular process of the arytenoid, and function is it opens the glottis. Lateral cricoarytenoid, and its origin is from the superior border of the lateral part of the arch of the cricoid. Here you can see here, and attached to the muscular process of the arytenoid. It is the muscular process of the arytenoid. This lateral cricoarytenoid attaches onto the muscular process of the arytenoid. It adducts and lowers the tip of the vocal process by rotating arytenoid medially. This is the picture showing, and this is the posterior cricoarytenoid muscle, posterior view, and this is the superior view. This is the collateral cricoarytenoid muscle. It is helpful in the adduction of the vocal ligaments. Next one is the transverse arytenoid or unpaid. These are the unpaid. These are present on the posterior surface of the muscular process and the outer edge of the arytenoid. Insertion onto the it crosses over and attaches to the same onto the other arytenoid. Function is it adducts the vocal fold and controls the position of the vocal fold. Adduction is nothing but the closure of the glottis. Oblique arytenoids, these are a pair, and posterior aspect of the muscular process of the arytenoid and insertion onto the apex of the other arytenoid. And their main function is adduction of the vocal cords. This is the transverse arytenoid muscle, that is intra-arytenoid muscle. These are the oblique intra-arytenoid muscles. Next one is the thyroarytenoid, lateral and above the free edge of the cricovocal ligament, and the lower part is thick and called as vocalis muscle. Originates from the back of the thyroid prominence and the cricothyroid lamina, whereas insertion is onto the vocal process of the arytenoid and anterolateral surface of the body of the arytenoid. Whereas in the case of cricothyroid, is the only intrinsic muscle that lies outside the cartilaginous framework of the larynx. All other intrinsic muscles of the larynx lie within the cartilaginous framework, whereas in the case of cricothyroid, this is the only muscle which is present outside the cartilaginous framework. This originates from the lateral surface of the anterior arch of the cricoid and insertion onto the lower oblique fibers and passed back and lateral to insert to the anterior border of the inferior corner of the thyroid cartilage, and anterior stride fibers attached to the posterior part of the lower border of the thyroid lamina. These are thyroarytenoid muscles, and these are the cricothyroid muscles, which is present outside the cricoid lamina, or the cartilaginous lamina, and this is the thyroarytenoid muscle. These are nothing but tensors. This is the cricothyroid muscle. It has got the oblique and the stride parts. Another one is the which alter the shape of the laryngeal inlet. Area epiglotticus. It is continuation of the oblique arytenoid. Origin is from the posterior aspect of the muscular process of the arytenoid and insertion onto the pass around the apex of the opposite arytenoid and insert into the AE fold. Function is weak sphincter of the laryngeal inlet. Thyroepiglotticus, it's continuation of the thyroarytenoid muscle, and its origin is from the back of the thyroid prominence and the cricothyroid ligament and pass upwards and it attaches onto the apex into the AE fold. And it widens the inlet of the larynx, pulling the AE fold slightly apart. These are the superior laryngeal muscle nerve, superior laryngeal nerve, internal branch and external branch. External branch goes downwards and supplies the cricothyroid muscle. Only laryngeal muscle which is supplied by the superior laryngeal nerve is the cricothyroid muscle. All other muscles are supplied by the recurrent laryngeal nerve. This is the recurrent laryngeal nerve. You can see the internal branch of the superior laryngeal nerve pierces the quadrangular membrane. Nerve supply of the muscles, motor supply, all intrinsic muscles of the larynx are supplied by the recurrent laryngeal nerve, except for the cricothyroid, which is supplied by the external laryngeal nerve. And sensory supply above the vocal cords, it is from the internal branch of the superior laryngeal nerve. Whereas below the vocal cords, vocal folds, it is from the recurrent laryngeal nerve. Cavity of the larynx and extend from laryngeal inlet to the lower border of the cricoid cartilage. Inlet borders anteriorly free margin of the epiglottis, posteriorly intra-arytenoid folds, and sides are formed by the AE folds. This is the laryngeal borders, and cavity has two pairs of mucosal folds, ventricular fold and the vocal fold. they divide the cavity into three parts, and above the vocal fold is the ventricle vestibule, and below the folds is the ventricle of the larynx, and below the vocal folds is the subglottic. This is the cavity of the larynx, and these are the vocal folds. This is the ventricular fold. This is the vocal fold, and this is the sinus of the larynx. You can see here clearly. These are the vocal folds, and these are the ventricular folds. In between these two is the ventricle, and which leads into the saccule of the larynx. And below is the subglottic area. This is the cricoid. This is the thyroid cartilage. And this is the lateral cricoarytenoid muscle, lateral thyroarytenoid muscle, and this is the vocalis muscle. Vocalis muscle is nothing but the thyroarytenoid muscle. Thyroepiglottic membrane, and this is the supraglottic area. This is the glottic area, and this is the subglottic area. Vestibular folds are also known as the false vocal folds. Fold of the mucous membrane extending anteroposteriorly across the laryngeal cavity. They contain the vestibular ligament, few fibers of the thyroarytenoid muscle, and the mucous glands. And this is the space between the right and left vocal folds is nothing but the rima vestibular, rima glottidis. Vocal folds are true vocal cords, two pearly shaped bands extending from the middle of the thyroid angle to the vocal process of the arytenoid. Posteriorly, it is limited by the intraarytenoid fold of the mucous membrane. Each vocal cord contains vocal ligament, which is covered by closely bound mucous membrane with scanty subepithelial connective tissue. Space between the vocal cords anteriorly and vocal process and the arytenoid base posteriorly is nothing but the rima glottidis, which is the narrowest part of the larynx. Whereas in the case of infantile larynx, the narrowest part is nothing but the subglottic area. Whereas in the case of adults, it is the rima glottidis area. It's about 24 mm in the case of men and 16 mm in the case of women. Vestibule of the larynx extends from the laryngeal inlet into the vestibular folds. Anterior wall is formed by the posterior surface of the epiglottis, whereas sides are formed by the AE folds. Posterior wall is formed by the mucous membrane over the anterior surface of the arytenoid. Ventricle of the larynx, it is called a sinus of Morgagni. It is a deep elliptical shape space between the ventricular and vocal folds. Saccule, it is the diverticulum of the mucous membrane from the anterior part of the ventricular cavity, extending upwards between the vocal cords and the lamina of the thyroid cartilage. You can see here in the picture, this is the ventricle which leads to the saccule. It has many mucosal glands which lubricate the vocal cords. When abnormally enlarged and distended, it may form a laryngocele, which is air-containing sac presenting in the neck. These laryngoceles are most commonly seen in the trumpet blowers and also in the glass blowers. Subglottic space, which is called as infraglottic larynx, extends from the vocal cords to the lower part of the cricoid cartilage. We're coming to the mucous membranes of the larynx. It lines the larynx and loosely attached, except over the posterior surface of the epiglottis, through vocal cords, corniculate, and cuneiform. Epithelium of the mucous membrane is nothing but the ciliated columnar epithelium, which is present in the respiratory tract. Epithelium of the vocal cords and the upper part of the vestibule is nothing but stratified squamous epithelium. And the mucous glands are present also. This is the only part which is covered by the stratified epithelium in the case of larynx. And so the vocal cord carcinoma, which is called as squamous cell carcinoma, arises from this part. Mucous glands are present in the entire larynx except over the vocal cords. Blood supply of the larynx up to the vocal folds, it is by the superior laryngeal artery, a branch of the superior thyroid artery, where a superior laryngeal vein drains from the superior thyroid vein. Below the vocal cords, it is from the inferior laryngeal artery, which is a branch of the inferior thyroid artery. There is the inferior laryngeal vein drains into the inferior thyroid vein. Lymphatic drainage is from above the vocal cords along the superior thyroid vessels to the anterosuperior group of the deep cervical group of fluids. Whereas in the case of below the vocal cords, it is a posterior inferior group of the deep cervical roots. Spaces of the larynx, these are divided into pre-epiglottic space, paraglottic space, and the ringi space. Pre-epiglottic space is bounded in front and upper part of the thyroid cartilage and thyrohyoid membrane, above by the higher epiglottic ligament, and behind by the infrahyoid epiglottis and the quadrangular membrane. Laterally, it continues with the paraglottic space. It's filled with the fat, areolar tissue, and some lymphatics. In the case of supraglottic carcinoma, this is the commonest location, that is the preepiglottic space, which is involved. And the paraglottic space, laterally, it is the thyroid cartilage. It is bounded by thyroid cartilage laterally. Inframedially, it is conus elasticus, which is nothing but the trichovocal ligament. And medially, it is by the ventricle and quadrangular membrane. Posteriorly, it is by the mucosa of the piriform fossa, and growth which involves this place can present in the neck through the cricothyroid space. The ringy space, it is under the epithelium of the vocal cord in this potential space with scanty subepithelial connective tissues, bounded above and below by the arcuate lines, in front by the anterior commissure and behind by the vocal process of the arcuate. The main point is here, you have to remember the ringy space is nothing but it is bounded between the anterior commissure and behind by the vocal process of the arytenoid. Edema in this space causes fusiform swelling of the mucous membrane, which is called as Ringi's edema. And this is the position of the vocal cords. Median, that is in the midline in the case of phonation, also in the case of decurrent laryngeal nerve paralysis. In the case of paramedian, the location is 1.5 mm from the midline, and it is seen in the case of strong whispers and also in some cases of recurrent laryngeal paralysis. Whereas in the case of intermediate, that is cadaveric position, it is 3.5 mm from the midline and neutral position of the cricoarytenoid muscle, and the paralysis of both recurrent laryngeal and superior laryngeal nerves. Gentle abduction, it is 7 mm from the midline. It is quiet respiration, it is seen in quiet respiration, that is normal respiration, also in the case of paralysis of the adductors. Whereas in the case of full abduction, it's most commonly seen in deep inspiration, and it is from 9.5 mm from the location of the midline. This is the picture showing the positions of the vocal cords in the case of different positions of the vocal cords. Remember about the Semon's law. In all progressive organic lesions, the phylogenetically new abductor muscles, abductor fibers are more susceptible and the first to be paralyzed compared to the adductor muscles. That is, abductor muscles are the first to get involved in the case of laryngeal paralysis when compared to the adductor muscles. Thank you.